little bit of information about him if you don't already know. He has a MA and a BA and an MA in English Literature and Creative Writing from the University of Windsor in Ontario. He also earned a PhD in English Literature from the University of Minnesota. His research explores issues of identity, nation, language, and technology. And his most recent critical project marries his previous interventions into Canadian poetry and national identity with the unique environment of Fort McMurray. His writing has appeared in Canadian Literature, English Studies in Canada, the Journal of Graphic Novels and Comics, Jim Henson in Philosophy, Arc Poetry Magazine, Carousel, and the Windsor Review. His D&D character, I didn't know people still had those. Okay. is an elven thief obsessed with the undead. On that note, join me in welcoming Dr. Ryan Cox to talk about poems.
All right, thank you, Lewis. So I want to start the talk with thank yous. And because the work I'm presenting tonight is very much interested in space and place, I think it's important to recognize where we are. So I want to recognize that this talk tonight here at Keyano College in Fort McMurray takes place on Treaty 8 land, the traditional home and still the home of the Cree, Dene, and Métis. I also want to thank the Alberta Foundation for the Arts, without whom nothing I am going to say to you tonight would have been written. The creative work I'm presenting tonight, was funded with a generous grant from the AFA. I also want to thank the Keyano College Learning Innovation Fund and Dr. Angelico Lazue, late of Keyano College, now of Grand Prairie Regional College, and the View from Here project participants who inform the critical aspects of the talk. And the Learning Innovation Fund gave me money that, because of reasons that are going to become apparent, I never spent. But I thank them for it anyway. All right, the intentional fallacy. This is what I intend to do tonight. I intend to discuss poetry and poetics. That's intention number one. Intention number two, I'm going to present poems for my most recent work, The Refugee Diary and De Doctrina Christiana. That's the second intention. Intention number three, I want to provide an example of how art and artistic practice can be used to confront a trauma like the fire. That's my third intention. The important thing always to remember about the intentional fallacy, whatever I intend to do, whatever it is I'm setting out to do tonight, well, we can't trust my intention. This is what I am going to attempt to share with you. It is up to you to judge what I actually do. So let's all bear that in mind. There's a version of this talk that is a much more formal discussion about how to write poems and poetic process. I want to offer the reason why we're not going to do that. This is an excerpt from my master's thesis, the title of which is terrible and I'm not telling you. I do recommend, if you ever have to title a work, don't title it half an hour before it's due. Yeah, you could all look that up on ProQuest and tell me about it later. But this was, this is the first sentence of the afterword, which was my statement of poetics at the time. And I say, I could describe the process I use when I write. Somehow, though, I am sure the image of me in boxer shorts, listening to loud music, typing by the light of my computer monitor in the wee hours of the morning is a great deal less romantic than it sounds. Every writer writes differently, and it's all wrapped up in process. The actual mechanics of writing, the technique, I can train you in technique. Enroll in a class, I'll train you in technique. But what it takes to actually make poems is, I think, only discernible in the work. So I'm not going to be formally telling you to how to sit down. Like, don't prepare your, I know there are lots of books that discuss this. I'm not going to tell you to prepare your writing space or to do every day sit down in the same spot with the same cup of coffee, with the same silence. They always recommend silence. I've never written in silence. I'm not going to do that. Instead, I'm going to kind of walk you through how the work that I've been writing for the past year happened. And in that way, and through that process, and through the content, and through perhaps what I intended to present in the poems, I hope to reveal how to write poems about fire. But this is a really weird headspace for me. I'm going to share with you my feelings. My really real feelings, too. And I feel a lot of things. So I'm going to start with two poems. These are both from The Refugee Diary. And The Refugee Diary is the poem I wrote that I wasn't supposed to. It was the poem I wrote during my time of exile, when, like I'm assuming most of the people in this room, I was forced to leave Fort McMurray and my home. It's the poem I wrote about the time when I had to return in order to assess the condition of my life. And it's the poem I've been about the experience of returning, of being back in the community. And as Kate, this excerpt from Kate Beaton's poem, comic Ducks, I feel a lot of things. So this is the first poem that I'm going to share with you tonight. Nighttime can be hard. Following the rough edge of insomnia to 100 million simulations and solutions of the crisis du jour, I've driven Highway 63 and scrubbed the walls of my house. I have packed everything I own into a U-Haul I leave in the parking lot at work, then headed inside to sleep under my desk. I've written cover letters for jobs in the Paw, Thompson, Peterborough, and North York, turning my time in the wilderness into qualifications and pedagogical innovations. I packed my car for return I can only really anticipate at this point. Then I get up, take a piss, throw myself back into bed, and hope pretending is the same as sleep. This was a state of being. This was a state of being, the state of my being at least, while I was an evacuee, or while I was displaced, or while I was in exile, or while I was a refugee. These are all things I actually thought, typically at 3 a.m. I will cop that the cover letters were written in my head for those positions in the Paw, Thompson, Peterborough, North York. Those were written in a Ramada, in my head in a Ramada bathroom in South Edmonton, because I wasn't sure the college was still here. And I needed to consider what was next. This gnawing uncertainty. All right. See, I was recording and then it's not gonna work. Anyway, this was the state of my mind. while I was away. It was constant uncertainty, it was a lot of confusion, and it was all I thought about. Especially all I thought about at 3 a.m. when it was really dark and the house was quiet. I'm going to share with you another poem. This is a poem from after my return. The weeds have grown 3 feet high through the cracks in the patio stones. As we cut them back, we expose burnt chunks of the neighbors' houses. And the shadows of plants and patio furniture etched in gray white ash like Hiroshima shadows. This is my backyard. Well, my patio. This is my back patio. These photos were taken about 2 to 3 weeks after we returned, probably mid-August. As my wife cut down the weeds in the garden, the weeds poking through, everything, what we found literally was burnt chunks of our neighbors' houses. They were just sitting there under the weeds. And the weeds themselves cast shadows and ash on the ground. It was a weird feeling. It was a really weird feeling. It was something that was really hard to overcome. Really hard to wrap your head around. This is kind of the state of affairs, I think, the community is living with. Or perhaps I'm projecting, it's the state of affairs I live with. As I said, this was not the poem I set out to write. This wasn't the poem I set out to write at all. This, by the way, is where you get my fire story. Because I know you all have fire stories. I have one too. Like some of you, I was here when the fire reached that point where we crept up on evacuation. I got very little notice. I headed back to my house. Beacon Hill and Abbasand were on fire at that point, noticeably so. The sky was verging on, depending on where you were in town, the sky was kind of a dull cheese yellow, or it was brown. It was smoke brown. I got home. I put my family and I got ready to go. We got stuck in traffic. We were later given the option of going north or south. I chose south and instantly blew a tire and then drove through downtown Fort McMurray at 100 kilometers an hour with a flat. And I changed it across the road from the Super 8. So it was a good time. Why this is relevant to these poems is, one, this is what I don't talk about in the poem. This is what we all don't talk about. We talk about it, but we don't. Instead, I write about the experience of being outside. I try to make sense of the experience and what I feel, but that moment, that fire story, has two material effects on the poetry I was writing. One, it made it impossible not to think about the fire, or at least my relationship to it. And in a very practical way, it meant I couldn't write the poem I was writing. The grant I received from the AFA was to write something called De Doctrina Christiana, the title I lifted from John Milton because I was being cheeky. It's okay, he lifted it from St. Augustine, near as I could tell. But it was to be a poem where I talked about God and creation and existence and my dad and the church and me and that kind of stuff, you know. What I sold it on, and so we I could go. I've looked at the grant application since. What I sold it on was I was going to talk about my experiences as a PK, as a preacher's kid, and my relationship to my father at the end of his career. And at the end, he had the end of career arc of most clergy, which it gets to you. That's a job that breaks you down. I started writing the poems. It was supposed to be my big breakthrough into actually writing about self, like really writing about me without ciphers or blocks. But I also, by virtue of the other things, I provided myself with cover. So the other material, things like the other material I was going to cover were things like epistemology. I was going to practice ekphrasis, so I was going to write about the aesthetic experience of other people writing about God, or playing music about God, or things like that. I was going to write about that. I was researching heavily depictions of saints. I was looking into different creation stories. I was doing this research. It was really heavily researched work. All of my research as I headed south towards Edmonton, with the town on fire behind me, all of my research was locked in my office. Everything. My books by Richard Feynman, Arthur Rimbaud, the Quran, my comic book Bibles, all were there behind me. So materially, the fire made it impossible to complete the work I was working on. And that's fine. This is an example of one of the, I'm going to share two examples of the work I was supposed to write. One shows you how I like to normally write, which is to filter everything through reference and kind of provide myself shields. Because I'm going to talk about creation and the universe, and it's not going to be particularly personal. It's good. It's very playful linguistically, I think. Physics seems to reveal an erotics of creation. Though the word creation may be an ill fit, as it implies intention. Before time, before the universe, there is a period of singularity. Infinitely hot, infinitely dense, infinitely energetic, but without matter. In this moment of singularity, in the tiniest of the spaces, there is nothing, but there is everything. There is no present, only the promise of a future. Before the universe, there is the potential of the universe. Before the universe, there is the anticipation of the universe. Before the universe, is there a desire for the universe? Something moves or nothing moves, but something happens. The singularity of the thing or nothing before builds and builds towards a moment of eruption, the Planck epoch, when infinite heat, infinite density, infinite energy become too much to restrain, to constrain, to concentrate. Time and space erupted into being. Time and matter and anything and everything spurt into being, just as the priests of Heliopolis and the Bell Telephone Laboratories recorded. So again, this first part of this poem was research, and I'm sure I have the science terribly, but it sounds nice poetically. And it's playing with language. This is a poem as much about language, so I'm looking at inversions and kind of ways words can loop in on themselves. I'm building to a crescendo. That's the erotics part. So this is what I was supposed to be writing. The other thing I was supposed to be writing, the stuff where I deal with kind of the personal, the emotional, is in a section called Station to Station, which is a Bowie record, but also was kind of, I thought was a cheeky reference to the Station of the Cross, and the fact that as a preacher's kid, you move a lot, a lot, a lot. So it was about that kind of movement, the movement itself, the relationship to the church. I was trying to effectively figure out why I don't go anymore. And my suspicion, and I'll tell, because I'm going to get really honest later, I can be honest with you now. I suspect the way people, the parishioners, treated my father towards the end of his career, made me angry enough I don't go. But I was searching for those experiences, that feeling. So this is a poem about searching for that feeling of the church. At night, I sing my son lullabies. Some old blues songs, old work songs, murder ballads, like In the Pines, or Long Black Veil. The part of all my loving I can manage to remember, or something by Graham Parsons. Sometimes, though, I sing him old church songs. Not hymns exactly, but church songs. I am a pilgrim, swing low, sweet chariot. Jesus loves me in this little light of mine. Songs that sway and stomp, hard-soled dress shoes on bare wooden floors, and a cool glass of water for a parched throat. Traveling songs where I can find every note, every touch of vibrato, every rise and fall, and dip into the minor key effortlessly with eyes closed. When I sing these songs, rocking back and forth, keeping time in the dark of my son's room, that old familiar feeling returns, the warm shiver of the spirit that I feel when I remember to pray. If I can just touch the hem of his garment, good Lord, then I know he'll take me home. So that's what I'm supposed to be writing. That's the kind of feeling I'm supposed to be exploring. And it's personal, but this poem is as much about the reference or that feeling. So it's less idiosyncratic. If you know those old songs that remind you, that stir you, you can feel it, whether they're church songs or not. This, incidentally, this is the Burgessville United Church in Mance. That's one of the places I grew up. That house there, that really, really old house that was built, I don't know, before the dawn of time. I lived there. You can see my bedroom window. It's kind of hiding behind the tree in the house in the background. That's where I grew up. That is the old red hymnal of the United Church and the Anglican Church, which I like better than the new one. But this is what I was supposed to be writing. But the fire happened. And for pragmatic reasons, I couldn't do it. The intellectual poems, the poems that rely on research, became impossible to write. So I wrote about what I was feeling and the place I was and how, and part of this is inflected by Fort McMurray. Fort McMurray is a really weird place. Fort McMurray is a really weird place. My current critical work is predicated on that notion that Fort McMurray is weird, that something's happening in Fort McMurray that's difficult. This is a picture. One of my students, the former students, I guess, on the A View From Here project is hiding her face. But this is us trying to, if you look at the board, we are trying to figure out Fort McMurray. The kind of key things are truth, and we got ideology, we got space, place, it says dialectics over there. What that means is Fort McMurray is complicated. Fort McMurray is really complicated. I didn't think I would ever be nostalgic about this place. Because, you know, they sell you the 5-year plan, right? It's year 5, I'm still here, and I don't necessarily have any plans to leave, as long as the town doesn't catch fire again. Fort McMurray is a weird place. And thinking about this experience is crucial. The way Fort McMurray, well, I'm going to quote myself because I said it smart once, so I'm going to try again. The Fort McMurray thing is complicated to explain. This stems in part from the inherent complexity of Fort McMurray as a space both real and imagined. The Fort McMurray that confronts most people in popular media is a discursive place that is defined from exterior positions. According to the dominant narratives, it is either the economic engine of the nation, responsible for Canada's current and future prosperity, or it is an environmental disaster, hastening the impending ecological crisis that will be responsible for the eventual destruction of the planet. These versions of Fort McMurray are both incomplete. Flawed products of ideology, identifying themselves by the careful choice of oil or tar sands. Like most totalizing narratives, they erase the complexity of the things they describe, obscuring and even erasing the city and the people who live there. That's what I thought before the fire. I mean, I wrote that after the fire, but that is a product of research I was doing at the time. Before the fire, I thought that Fort McMurray was a complicated place where we all live in the center of a dialectic that never quite resolves, and it's a product of competing external narratives. Then I had to watch my town on fire on the news for a long time. Watch them mispronounce place names. Watch them talk to weird, random folks from town. The people they picked to put on the news, and I have no idea how they ended up there. But there was this, the world was representing my home and my experience in a moment of crisis. That's a complicated thing to deal with. Fort McMurray is a complicated space, and the fire made it more complicated. One of the things that has always fascinated me and bothered me about representations of Fort McMurray are the lack of recognition of the experience in the space, the real lived experience, the incoherence of our experience. I looked at a class of students today and told them the reason we're all here is colonialism, and then the reason we're all here is because of oil. Even me. And I, as I revealed to them, the only thing I'm clear that they do out at sight is there are haul trucks. Some mine, I think, and SAG-B is a thing, but I don't know. But I'm here, the reason I'm here, the reason this building's standing in some ways is because of oil. So Fort McMurray is a complicated place because I'm not pro-corporate. I'm not pro-corporation. I'm pro Fort McMurray. This is home. So I wanted to offer, watching all these external representations, and there are other things that happened, like, oh, the Red Cross and the province are doing a bang-up job getting money to people. Not me. I got caught on the phone line with the Red Cross. They put me on hold for 2.5 hours at one point, because they didn't want to tell me let's choose the more polite word, but you can imagine the one I'm thinking. They screwed up my relief. They gave me the wrong number, and then they wouldn't tell me they did, so they put me on hold for 2.5 hours. It's humiliating and dehumanizing, and then I watched the news, and the Red Cross is working for sainthood. It wasn't my experience. I recognize it wasn't everyone's experience, mine, but there's that. So what I ended up doing is I started writing about the fire. I started writing about being trapped in my in-law's basement. Started writing about the uncertainty and the feeling. I started recording the actual event as I experienced it. I started writing what the Canadian poet Dorothy Livesey describes as a documentary poem. So Livesey says that documentary poetry is a genre in which historical or other found material is incorporated into the writer's own thoughts in order to create a dialectic between the objective facts and the subjective feeling of the poet. The effect is often ironic. It is always intensely personal. So I can't speak for everyone in Fort McMurray. I know other people have different experience of what happened in the fire. I know I always feel uncomfortable talking about my trauma because I know people who had it worse than I did. And I know this is a prevailing school of thought, is that if you still have a house, shut the fuck up. And that's not an imposed from the people who lost. That's an internal feeling. So I started writing through this experience, and I started thinking about the material condition of Fort McMurray, the lived experience, the news, everything I knew, the things I could gather critically, and the things that were informing my critical work. And I refracted it through my experience, and I ended up writing a poem, like Livesey said, that is always intensely personal. One of the things I had wanted to do with De Doctrina Christiana was to stop using ciphers and masks and other things to distance the self from the poem. Apparently all it took was trauma. Because I wrote really personal things. Really kind of intensely personal things. What I'm sharing with you tonight, I've been very uncomfortable about the idea of reading it in public. Because this is me. This is my blood. All over the stage, all over the page. That's a weird feeling. Normally, because normally performance is easy. You come up, you put on the mask, and you go. And this is real stuff. This is real stuff. I'm not going to talk about this, but you all know exactly what this means. And this is a thing that's still there, that whiff of smoke in the air, and you get a little antsy, I'm sure. I'm going to read another poem. Four houses on my street burned down last night. Municipality says a fire. Province says an explosion. Took 18 hours to get bootleg photos passed from a friend to a friend to a friend. So I couldn't see it wasn't mine. So I could see if I still had a place to go back to. Still no official images, no official confirmation. We left 15 days ago. The slow motion panic, Schrodinger's house. We were supposed to be past this part. I wanted to be past this part. I Googled whether stress aggravates pleurisy. There are 10 pages of results. I can't tell if this is comforting. That's a real experience. Line breaks and I wordplay. Attention to the musicality of the line, trying to force poetry into that, what I like to consider the condition of poetry, which is language in an excited state. That's where we get Schrodinger's house, because I thought that was word that kept rolling around in my head as I thought about the fact that I didn't know if my house was there. So this is recognizable to any of you who lived through the fire. This is the image of my house that the municipality provided to say that my house was still there. So if you look, you can see my yard, and it's there, and then it's still there. It's kind of great. It's kind of fantastic. By the way, this is the last slide when I went to Acute to present on Fort McMurray, and this was the last slide in that, and they were all like, oh, yeah. Less than 6 hours after this happened is when I got news of the fires on Sillin Forest in my condo unit. Not my unit, but in my, like, where the condos are. So we had a brief moment of elation and relief where we knew everything was fine. And then you return to that feeling of uncertainty. That's a real lived experience. It's a complicated experience, and it's a challenging one. It's a painful one. It needed to get out . So there it is. This is an attempt to represent what is ultimately unrepresentable. In some ways, I think that's the challenge with this work. I had to figure out how to represent the unrepresentable, because I didn't understand. I didn't understand what I felt myself. I knew I felt things, but I didn't understand it. And then there's the other things that start happening. So I was away. I was out of town, I was in Ontario. That's where I wrote out things till I could come back. And everybody wanted to see us. Everybody we knew, some people we didn't, but they knew people we knew. Like, we were given lots of hospitality. The one thing I can say about the rest of Canada, the people who weren't here, they were incredibly generous. But there was a cost. There was a cost. There's something that isn't necessarily acknowledged in the exchange, but it's still an exchange. This poem's about that exchange. We pay for hospitality with disaster porn. People want to know what it was like. They want to take a little piece of us, the places licked by flame, choking on smoke, and hold it tight. I thank Christ this can't happen here. And what would I do? What would I carry with me? Talisman. Playing Lazarus is fine. I don't mind. Though I hold things back, they're only mine. The calm, strangely rational thought about whether we would see our home again as I pulled out of the driveway. The helplessness of sitting behind the wheel when Malcolm learns to say home for the first time as we're stuck in the crush of traffic, desperately trying to leave home in the city, again later when he spits up in the back seat. Sticky, clear, bubbled stuff, like nightmare corn syrup, because he got a lung of smoke. We don't have any water in the car. We were only going to be on the road a few minutes. Watching the fuel needle descend towards the E that meant we're stuck on the side of the highway, and I chose wrong when I chose south. The open expanse of Canada and Edmonton's malls. The litany of prayers asking for little more. Asking for little more than a few kilometers and a gas station. It sometimes feels like an uneven exchange, unbound as it is from real generosity, but it's mostly harmless. Sometimes, though, I just want to forget where I'm from and keep the ashes to myself. So this is a thing that isn't represented in most of the media I've seen about the fire. Everybody wanted to know what it was like. And I had a good story. So the driving through the hill with the flat, and I made it to Edmonton on the donut. I was not driving. They say you're only supposed to do 80 kilometers an hour at max on a donut, and that was not what I was driving. I had a good story. Everybody wanted it. They wanted to know how we were. They wanted to see us. What they wanted to talk about with the fire. And the first few times is fine. Or when it's family, and there's a legitimate concern, you know that they're worried about you. But then there's everybody else. That far picture, that's my son in the back seat of the car the day of the evacuation, holding his dinosaurs. That's a picture I don't like looking at. That's the picture everybody wanted. There are other things wrapped up in these photos. There are other things wrapped up in these photos in this experience. It's really kind of, that's submerged, that's not quite acknowledged, I think. Or if it is, it's given lip service. It's about the kind of, I'm interested in the constant kind of re-traumatization. And I'm sorry, I really am, if what I'm saying is having that effect on any of you. But I watch my three-year-old, I watch him exhibit signs of post-traumatic stress disorder. I watch him have flashbacks. Not often. Do you understand how terrifying that is? That's something we're not talking about. That's, again, something that needs to be represented. So, Malcolm is playing in the yard at his grandparents' house, his own variation on Calvin Ball. It relies heavily on the participation of dinosaurs, Hot Wheels, rubber worms, and Captain Barnacles. He is laughing, running between his mother and the Tyrannosaurus on the other side of the yard, and then he stops dead. The neighbors are barbecuing on a charcoal Weber. They've just removed the lid to check on the state of things, and Malcolm sees the smoke as it rises placidly above the fence. And Malcolm catches the scent of burning wood in his nose. And he stops laughing, stops running. He gathers us up as we gather his toys and leads us inside to safety. That happened. He's running around the yard and the neighbors are barbecuing and he had that reaction. Smelled smoke, saw smoke. He took us inside. That's difficult. That's difficult. It's difficult for me. This is part of that attempt to represent the unrepresentable. Because this is something I don't want to represent to myself. On the weekend, while I was at convocation, I was feeling really good at convocation. He saw a video that had a toy that we bought him when we were in the first Ramada in Edmonton, because we stayed in two. The second one had a furry convention because God is clearly a fan of absurd humor. But he saw that toy on the TV. And it just clicked into a loop. He just kept repeating and repeating and repeating and apparently was really on edge. Had to be calmed down, TV went off, had his mother calmed him down. I was feeling really good that day. And I heard about that. Yeah. I should have a better transition than that. yeah, no, I need to laugh a little bit. So I'm going to talk about other stuff. So in thinking about my experience of the fire, one of the quirky things that happened to me is because I rent, I had to, my landlord's insurance company insisted that I clear everything out of the house before they'd let the cleaners in for remediation. Because we had smoke damage, moderate smoke damage. Did I put that picture in? Let's see. No. I have moderate smoke damage. I found 3 spots of soot in the whole house. But I had to take everything out. So, this is again part of that process, is think about your coping mechanisms while you're writing. Because writing is a coping mechanism. I'm thinking about returning. Think about coming. I had to come back and pack up my whole house. Look at everything. And so I would like to show you the valuable things that I left behind. These were things that I did not deem worthy of putting in the car as we were escaping a natural disaster. You can see my son's baby book. Our wedding rings. So that was a photo I sent to my wife to show her that I had all of the wedding rings. My diploma. That is 6 years of my life on a piece of cardboard, and I forgot to grab it. You don't think about these things, right? This is that moment. Everyone's really interesting in what you do bring. If you look at a lot of the news stories after the fire, a lot of them are like, well, what did you evacuees bring with you? And everybody had wacky stories because everybody was in a state of panic and threw whatever they could into their car. These are the things I forgot. And the things I had rediscovered and held in my hand while I was packing up my house. This poem's about the preparation to go there. The preparation to go back, because I went back. Amanda and I have rediscovered the hipster coffee joint in Westdale, by the Art House Theater and the Japanese Candy Emporium. This is what civilization feels like to us. We used to live in Minneapolis. This is where we come to take little breaks from our lives, the Hamilton version, which has never actually been living for me. Not even when I lived here before we hit the highway headed north and west. We drink lattes crafted with artisanal care by pierced people. Surrounded by what I know without asking our grad students and pretend that we are what we were when we were these people. But certain things can't help sneaking into our conversation. Amanda is trying to control the uncontrollable by giving me instructions, things that need to be done, things that can be disposed of, things we can lose. For my part, I'm pretending I'm not literally sick with worry, aware that the cute girl at the table next table is struggling with post-structuralism, rather than mentally estimating damage and losses in a house touched by fire. 30% is the number we kick around as we eat birthday cake bars. I stare out the coffee shop window and try to imagine what that looks like. I stare out the coffee shop window and remember when this conversation was about the new Hold Steady record or Tarantino film. That's a really weird thing. I don't know if you had to do it, if anyone should have to, no one should have to do it. Because we hadn't lost everything, we had to imagine how much we did. So try to imagine, we were batting, no one gave us any hard number, there was never any information. And so, try to imagine what 30% of the things you own look like. It's weird, it's disconcerting. And we were really trying to be normal. This was our escape. We tried to go back to being normal, and the cute girl across at the other table, clearly, like, grads, it was just grad students everywhere, and she was trying to, I think, figure out, difference, and I was like, what does my house look like? Please don't make me go. Because that's what I was thinking, is don't make me go. Poetry is about exposure here. It's about memory. It's about blending these experiences. It's about trying to retrace feeling, to return to a moment of truth. I kept returning to a moment of truth. It would have been really nice if I could have just looked at, because, oh God, writing poems about girls is easy. So easy. It's so easy. Reference, danger, pretty smile, destruction. There you go. That's insert some words that kind of vaguely follow that arc. That is a poem that I would write about a girl. And I know this because I've written a lot. But instead, it's like, how much? What? Okay, when I get in, okay, I could throw this out, and they said I could sleep in the bed, but maybe I can't. I don't know. Oh, shit. They're going to make me go. This is the experience. It's sitting in the space, waiting to go back, waiting to figure it out. The uncertainty, representing uncertainty. Then there's, now we're back. So we've, in theory, moved past uncertainty, haven't we? That's what they tell us. We're moving past uncertainty. This is another place I think poetry is very useful in confronting this trauma. We're supposed to be past uncertainty. We're resilient and strong. The signs all over town tell us that. They do, everywhere you look. Everywhere that it tells you that we're going to be resilient, we're going to rebuild. That seems to be the running theme. The landscape of the city remains marked by a proliferation of lacuna. Spaces, social and commercial, that refuse to situate themselves on the map, alive and dead simultaneously. We fill these spaces with their unfathomable contours, and their unfathomable contours with rumors whispered over coffee, over office lunches, that code our own untouched silence. Purposely blank slide. Because there are a lot of places that aren't back. There are a lot of places that aren't back. We're not supposed to talk about them, I don't think. But we do. How many conversations have I had over lunch about whether the Dairy Queen is coming back? The Dairy Queen, and I mean, this is kind of a fascinating thing, but that coming back seems to be important to the community, at least my community. And we talk about it, but we don't know anything about anything. He's like, well, I heard that they're going to open that there, or, oh no, they're totally done. Or, I think the ice cream became sentient and bears. I don't know. There's a lot of unknowing. And I posit, generally, my critical writing about Fort McMurray, that this constant state of unknowing is a natural state for us. We live in a state of knowing unknowing, where we are aware of the fact that this is all very confusing. Yeah, there's just spaces, and we don't necessarily acknowledge these absences, these breakages. And there are a lot of breakages in town. And we think about just shops and places and stuff that's not back. That's one thing. There are people who aren't back. I heard a statistic that said 80,000 people are back in town. And I want to know where they are. Except tomorrow afternoon, they will all be at Walmart. Because this is Fort McMurray and it's Saturday afternoon. But there's that. There's this question. There's still an uncertainty in the here. Fort McMurray isn't back. At least it's not back the way it was. I'm going to explore this idea through my personal hobby horse, Fort Mac Strong. Fort Mac Strong. Oh, Lord, Fort Mac Strong. You see it literally on every surface in town. I'll actually let the poem I wrote about that phenomenon speak a little better. Because it sounds better. They're plastered, they've plastered every surface in this town with Fort Mac Strong and its permutations. The lampposts, the pickup trucks, every store that has managed to open. I have a strong suspicion that they've been tattooing it on the faces of children. Every surface in this town has Fort Mac Strong on it. And it's a problematic construction. When I write about the poems about it are kind of from a frustrated and ironic point, because I'm a little punky. And I understand the comfort the idea gives, but I'm not strong anymore. I was strong when I was away. When I was out, I was strong, because I had to be. I don't want to be strong anymore. I want it to be acknowledged that it fucking hurts. It hurts. I don't know what it is, but I hurt. This narrative, the Fort Mac Strong narrative, excludes that moment of hurt. It excludes that narrative of hurt, of weakness. We're not allowed to be weak. I'm weak all the damn time. I suck it up. That's not healthy. It's having other kind of, there. Oh, no. That'll make more sense in a minute. There we go. Because there's some confusing things wrapped up in Fort Mac Strong. You can't see it. I'm going to point at it with the laser. See this one below the Alberta? That's the resistance fist. That's a thing that's been popping up in relation to Fort Mac Strong. And one of the things that's really weird about this community after the fire is the way it's appropriating symbols. So Fort Mac Strong and Alberta Strong were already a thing that were appropriated from Boston. Because we are a world-class city. So we're going to steal from Boston. I'll be moving to Sunny, somewhere else, immediately following this talk. But then the fists, the resistance fists, have been showing up on cars, white ones typically. So this is a poem about that. Fort McMurray, we need to talk about the raised fist that's been showing up on the back windows of white Dodge Rams, declaring the driver Fort Mac Strong. The fire changed a lot. I know it's changed me, but I don't think it's changed you that much. We keep electing Tories in the Wild Rose, and I see bumper stickers, I Heart Oil stands, and rebel flags. Too often to be convinced, so I'm afraid you have a bad case of the Inigo Montoyas. That fist means something. And wobblies don't drive big white Dodge pickups with SXT appearance group options. They ride the bus. Maybe if we had tried shouting, no pasaran, at the fire, this would have ended much quicker. And production out at Syncor probably, or it wouldn't have been disrupted. And I can't tell if it's worse if you don't know about the Popular Front and the Ludlow Massacre or Fred Hampton, or if you don't care. This is my kind of spilling, and something that really does bother me. That white fist is a symbol of the resistance of oppressed peoples. It's been used as symbols in the labor movement. It was popularized in North America by the IWW in their labor struggles around the turn of the 20th century. It became a symbol of black power, particularly the black resistance fist. The ones we keep seeing in Fort McMurray are white. The white fist tends to be a symbol of white power and white nationalism. It means something. And I talked to a person I know who of color, and I was talking to them about Fort Mac Strong and my particular objections. She acknowledged that she's seen it and she knows what it means. This is a thing that's in our community and we're not talking about. We may be changed. What's that change look like? So, yeah, so, one of the things that's really important that poetry does is it acknowledges change, or it acknowledges the weirdness of lived experience. This is about, this is a poem about a girl. I told you they're easy to write. But it's not really about a girl. It's about unpacking my office. They packed up my office because tangentially related to the fire, and I had to unpack it afterwards. And I was getting really into the rhythm of unpacking everything I own on a regular basis, so it was good. I was in my office, and I was unpacking. The fire has this weird tendency to expose things about the community. One, we probably need more than one road out of town. Two, we are a remarkably civil group. 88,000 folks evacuated and with minimal fatalities. That's pretty impressive. So that's not something people would think about Fort McMurray. This is another thing just that got exposed because of the fire. In unpacking my office. Unpacking my office. The old death trap carpet, a welcome casualty of the fire. Pulling books from boxes packed by the college, I try not to notice the whiteboard eraser packed on top of my collection of rare books. The books on the shelf go on the shelf without a sense of order, creating a palimpsest, creating a montage, an intellectual biography that only I can fully trace. A slip of paper falls, reveals itself after a year or two or three. A name and a phone number. Student. Girl. Beautiful. Clever. Sweet smile. It's written in handwriting that with its soft curves and lack of angles is definitively not mine. I'm sure there's an innocent reason I'm in possession of that name and the phone number. But I can't for the life of me remember what that reason is. Secret histories exposed by the fire stick to us all, ashes under our fingernails. So that happened. I still have it because it's weird. There are weird kind of symbols of the fire for me. That's one of them. I was unpacking my things and a former student's with her name written in girly writing and a phone number on it, fell out of my books. So that was a really confusing experience, because at once you're kind of like, I gotta get my books on. It was a weird thing, and I started to think back, what is this about? And there are probably lots of logical, innocent reasons for it, and that's probably all there is. My immediate supervisor is in the room, so that's definitively. But this is one of those. I don't know if you experienced this, but this is a thing that I've been constantly experiencing around the fire: is the exposure of things that have been submerged, or weird happenstances. The fire is kind of a catalyst for knowledge. So, that's how you know I'm transitioning poems. So, this is a photo taken by Brooke Lacey. It's the image I've been using on the posters, that we used on the posters for this. It is the woods around Fort McMurray post-fire. As you can see, the trees are all scorched. And the undergrowth is a vibrant electric green. One of the things, too, I think poetry can do by helping us acknowledge our pain and our trauma, by helping reveal these histories, these real histories, this documentary poem, that tension between the real and the subjective, and that dialectic, that synthetic moment that's always intensely personal, often ironic. I think it also can provide an opportunity to express a desire for hope. And that's where I want to leave you, at least in terms of discussing, sharing the work. This is, I'm calling it the dream poem. It doesn't have a formal title, because none of the work does. It's all refugee diary entry X, Y, or Z. But this is from, and Zed, and it's about that desire for the green. We drift through shadows into the ruined parts of town, unseen by the checkpoint keepers and demolition men, until we are alone in Beacon Hill, until we are alone in Abbasand, until we are alone in waterways, and strip our clothes away to stand awkwardly naked in the Alberta moonlight. Our eyes wander over new Gothic landscapes until our gazes meet and we move towards embrace, as extrinsic music fills our ears fully and completely. This is not an act of strength, but a surrender to magic and the things that lurk. It is not a rebuild, but the prelude to a rebirth. One of the things I've become absolutely convinced of writing this poem is, one, I'm deeply changed. I would say probably in some ways for the worse, in other ways for the better. But I'm changed. The experience changed me. The experience changed this town. We don't know what normal is. We're not back there. We can't say that in official documents. We can't say that. We can't say that because we're the hub of the economy. We can't say that because we're strong. But we're changed. Work of poetry. The work of a poet is to understand his or her experience and refract it. The role of the reader is to receive those words and understand them in the way that is relevant to them. What I want not is not a rebuild. We can't go back to what it was. But something new can be born here. Something new can be born here. We can make this something. That's that desire, that need to make, that need to create, the need to engage with the greenery that comes up through fire. That's how you write poems. I tell students when they take my creative writing classes, anyone can write. You want to be a writer? Grab a pen and some paper, write down whatever it is that comes to mind on that paper. You're a writer. You take my class, I can train you to be a technician. I can train you to be a technician. If you want writing tips, focus on image. Jesus, God. Images. Too many poems have no images, especially from amateur writers. So images, there you go. I can train you to be a technician. That last bit, that understanding how to write, how to express language, use language in an excited state to express. I don't want to sound Wordsworthian, but to express something important. That's the work of a poet. To work through that, you need to understand, you need to get in touch with both the language and the feeling. I want to build, I want to create. That's the word poesis, the Greek root of poetry, means to make. Let's make something. Thank you. All right. I'll take questions if you want. If you don't, I won't. I will say, if you by the door, the last poem I read, I printed a broadsheet of. And you can take that home and keep it forever. It's a limited edition of 26, all hand lettered. It's a lettered edition and signed. And that's another kind of poetic thing. We could talk about my interest in ephemera later. But that's there. Take them home, or I'll take them and I'll put them in my files. Are there any questions? Yep. What's that? I can't. In terms of classes, well, where's Lewis? Probably next fall would be the next time we'd offer introduction to writing poetry. That's my time is spoken for till then. But next fall, it's a credit course, so. So it's a credit course, so you could transfer it if you ever wanted to. But that's what we're doing. There are also occasions I have worked in the past with the public library doing workshops for kids. And I don't know if we're still doing that because the fire is a wonderfully disruptive thing. I have worked in the past doing workshops around writing for the municipality through Words in Motion, so that might happen. But we formally offer a class maybe in the fall. That's a conversation we'll have probably in spring. But if you want that to happen, find friends and tell him. Yep. Yes. Yes. Oh, Jesus God. It was the most surreal thing. It was, there's a poem in, there's a section in the poem that, where I just bring that up, because it was kind of an overwhelming experience, but it was short and vulgar, so I didn't share it. It was basically like, let's see if I can, the hotel we're staying, there is a goddamn furry convention in this hotel, fuck me. Yeah, so it was a little bit shorter and to the point, less demonstrating my skills. But that was, yeah, there was a furry convention in the hotel, and it was terrifying. On the phone in the restaurant in the hotel with the Red Cross and their people in fursuits at other tables, it's just weird. The whole thing's weird. This is the other thing we don't talk about enough, is how surreal the experience is. And I mean in a literal, theoretical, aesthetic way. This, we lived through a surreal moment. Yep. I was. The furry convention probably. Yeah. Because the only people in that hotel were evacuees and furries. You could tell the evacuees, they all had this kind of 10,000-yard stare, and they were all a little dirty, myself included, because you just couldn't get it off you. And just everyone looked exhausted and like death, and then there were furries. And there was a moment we were getting on an elevator, and the one guy in a full Minotaur costume asked if it'd be okay, like he was going to take another elevator, in case he scared Malcolm, my son. And we were polite and said no, because it wouldn't scare Malcolm. I was creeped the hell out. And I mean, if that's your deal, fine. But I didn't mention to him that, like, your life choices baffle me. Your life choices baffle me, and I don't understand what's happening. Yeah, and it was a bit absurd. Sure. Anything else? Yeah, Lewis. partially. I needed to do something. So the way I deal with trauma and stress is I make things. Mostly I write, but writing is work. So other times so the first weekend we were in Hamilton, I was just going mad. So we went, and I had to buy a guitar in Hamilton, Ontario, that I had to bring back because I needed to do something and make something. So I bought a guitar and I played until my fingers hurt and that. But searching for normalcy, I did other work. So I worked on my course pack for the fall, and I worked on my course outlines. But I was bracketing about, I was finding about every morning after I finished my coffee on the computer, I would start to write. So it did. There was the personal way, the way I deal with trauma and stress and all that. I make things, mostly poems. I also wrote a really great essay for the Association of Canadian College and University Teachers of English panel or conference in Calgary. So that helped too, but I had to write and I had to express an image. I had to speak about Fort McMurray from within so I could deal with whatever it was I was feeling, because it needed to get out. Yeah. It's the drive. I couldn't not do it. So it happened. And it meant that I wrote the thing I wasn't supposed to, but it's kind of better. It's better than the thing I had. It's better. This is better. The Refugee Diary, the poem about the fire, I will say is probably a more significant innovation in my aesthetic than the De Doctrina Christiana would have been. What a fascinating stuff! And there's some good stuff in there. I know I have to read it so that I can prepare it and revise it. This is better. So, for what it's worth, that drive to write, that drive to make in the face of trauma, was professionally significant. It's a really weird way of expressing it, isn't it? Anyone else? Anything else? All right. I think I was promised snacks. I think there should be snacks out in the lobby there. If you would like to get a hold of me to learn more about me, my contact information is up there. My email is ryan.cox@keyano.ca. My Twitter handle is @RyanJCoxPhD. My website is ryanjcox.com. That is also a product of the fire. If you came tonight and you were at all interested in me talking about dealing with this stuff creatively, I really would encourage you to come to the next installment of the lecture series. I would encourage you to do it anyway, but if there's any resonance that way for you, it is December 2nd. My colleague Laura Roberts, our sociologist and political scientist, is giving her talk, Dancing Under the Chemo Tree, and she's going to talk about the use of dance as therapy, and particularly refracting it through her experience going through cancer. And she's not here because she's dancing right now. So I really would encourage you, to come. Okay? All right, I'm not talking anymore.